Introduction told me, and you, we all learned together. So thank you for being here on what I take to be the first day of snow. It can't quite decide whether it's snowing or not, but I was advised I better get a girlfriend. So, but I won't tell my wife. So in some ways, it is fitting that I end a trip, an intellectual trip, which started about 5 or 6 years ago, which started in Seoul, that I ended in Seoul. I came here, I think in 2008, I can't quite remember, maybe 2009, invited by the East Asia Institute, where I got a fellowship. And it was a very generous fellowship, which took me to 5 universities, the institutes here, Fudan, Beida, Todai, and Taipei. Having written a paper in which I try to articulate what this project would try to do. And the paper was not as crisply formulated as this beautiful little book, which, by the way, I've never had a book of mine published in 2 weeks. This is a record of sorts, which I will talk to Cornell University Press about. They take 12 months, so. If we learn together, the together is not just in this room. The together for me was actually learning a great deal from Korean, Japanese, and Chinese scholars in particular. And I was learning for myself, of course, but I was learning largely prompted by my students, people like you. The lecture hall is just about the same size. I just finished teaching the course. It's the Introduction to International Relations for about 300 students. And each year, for the last 15 or 20 years, I've taught the course for 30 years, I asked them, so what are your favorite readings? And inevitably, among the top three is Samuel Huntington's The Clash of Civilization. This is not a testimony to my teaching skills, since I argue against that piece as much as I can. They like the piece. And in some ways, the project was a way for me to articulate clearly why do they like it so much and why is it so wrong. And that is basically this lecture, and President Drew has already indicated the bottom line. So as far as I'm concerned, you can now fall asleep. Okay. So the bottom line is, I think, the title of Rifkin's book, which is The Civilization of Empathy, and Rifkin is talking about a civilization, not in the plural, as I will in this lecture, but a civilization in the singular, which has to address the coming crisis of the material world, which we all have to address. I landed in an airport which is built on an island. That airport will not be there 60 years from now. Wall Street will not be there 60 years from now. This global warming is going to change how cities will look. Amsterdam is preparing for becoming a floating city. Rifkin is talking about a challenge out of the material conditions of life, which may make the kinds of cultural arguments which are in Huntington's book or article and these sets of arguments look one-sided. The Wilson argument about consilience, which is, as far as I can see, an argument which reduces human life and human ideas to its biological material foundation, is diametrically opposed to the logic which lies behind this lecture. I will briefly refer to the history of the fortune cookie in this lecture, And I'm a firm believer in fusion cooking, of taking this and that and making up new dishes. And that is not consilience, that's eclecticism. So the intellectual spirit of this lecture is actually quite different from Wilson's, because I think Wilson argues as a natural scientist and believes that the world can be reduced to its physical components and that everything derives from that. And I think that's only half true. I think ideas have their own independent life. So the first slide, which you will see eventually, has a picture of President Hu and Samuel Huntington. Professor Huntington was a colleague of mine. I was not his student. But the book he published, based on that article, was translated into 39 languages, including Korean. It was undoubtedly the most important book in my discipline, international relations. But it wasn't just the president who viewed the world in these terms. President Hu Jintao writes in few years ago, we must clearly see that international hostile forces are intensifying the strategic plot of westernizing and dividing China, and ideology and cultural fields are the focal areas of their long-term infiltration. We should deeply understand the seriousness and complexity of the ideological struggle. Always sound the alarm and remain vigilant and take forceful measures to be on guard and respond. He has read The Clash of Civilizations. He views civilization in terms of binaries, of difference between East and West. So it isn't just an issue of a professor or an intellectual position. It is an issue of political leaders and world politics. So what do the president and the professor agree on? Oh, by the way, yes, look for Korea if you can. And this is a very interesting question to which I will come in a second. So civilizations in this perspective are combative or clashing. And in this lecture, I will argue that they are plural and pluralist. They're plural. There's several of them in the world. Nobody knows how many, because the origin of human life in Africa is also the site of numerous civilizations, but scholars have not been able to agree whether it's 10 or 20 or 30. So it's plural, but it's also pluralist. That is, these civilizations are internally pluralist. They are not homogeneous, they're not coherent, they don't crystallize values. These internal core values instead are in battle with each other. They consist out of multiple traditions. This is a term which I will use a couple of times, so that the political disagreements and the intellectual diversity of each of these traditions creates lively exchange and competition. Now, this argument, which I'm developing, disagrees with the two primary arguments which exist in international relations. One is cultural realism, which is Professor Huntington and President Hu Jintao. But the other one, which you will know, is what I would call cosmopolitan liberalism. Cosmopolitan liberalism agrees that civilizations are pluralist internally. But it argues that the standard of proper conduct internationally exists in the singular. It's the liberal standard. And that insistence makes, in fact, the liberal argument look remarkably similar to the civilizational argument of the 19th century, which was profoundly racist and gender-specific. So when I give this lecture in the United States, I have virtually the entire lecture hall against me, because the lecture hall will be full either of realists or of liberals, and the lecture which I'm giving is a disagreement with both. So what about Korea? And here I have a question for you, and I hope you will pose it to me and we can explore it after the lecture together. I'd always thought of Korea as having a profoundly strong sense of national identity, located as it was between Japan on the one hand and China on the other. And the country I would like to always thought compare to Korea would be Poland, which was located between Germany and Russia. And Polish nationalism is the strongest nationalism in Europe for that very reason. If you live next door to two major powers and you're a relatively smaller country, you better have a small, a strong sense of self, national self. But it may well be that Korea is actually its own civilization. And if it is, of course, the relationship between civilization and nationalism becomes an interesting and highly debatable point. I've been in an extensive email conversation last night with a friend of mine in China who explained to me that in Chinese understandings, nationalism, a cosmopolitan nationalism, which includes all the minorities, is in fact the encompassing concept within which civilization and an ethnically informed exclusive form of nationalism are embedded. In the English language, civilization would be the encompassing term in which nationalism is embedded. So Korea would, I think, from this perspective, give us lots of interesting subjects to talk about. And I know nothing about Korea. So how do we locate the topic of the lecture, civilization, in the common terminology? The common terminology does not talk about civilization. It talks about globalization. And globalization is, in fact, a term used not by all the social sciences. It is used primarily by sociologists and anthropologists. Globalization argues that for states, it would be sovereignties, but for other actors, it would be other kinds of identities which would be transformed by the modern world. And the term glocalization was imported actually from Toyota and Toyota City, which was saying that new combinations emerge between global and local constellations, between the study of global phenomena in this university and the conditions on this university campus. So the concept of the world, which behind us, this concept of globalization, is very abstract. There is no meaning attached to the concept of globalization, although you read about it in the newspapers all the time. There's a second concept there, not globalization, but internationalization. Internationalization is a concept used primarily by economists and political scientists. Why? Going back to the Latin root of the term, internationis, they argue that what defines the modern world is not the reconfiguration of identities and practices, but instead the exchange of more and more stuff across national borders. Things like goods, people, services, information, all the things, information in particular, which I assume many of you by now are multitasking, looking at your iPad or iPhone, yes, and those flows of information have become very, very large, very rapid, but they don't necessarily transform who you are as students or who we are as societies. So the internet was created by the Defense Department in the United States in the 1960s as a state-initiated form of national defense to prepare the United States for nuclear war and make sure that a second strike could still be launched once nuclear bombs had fallen on the United States. But the World Wide Web, which emerges from the internet, is in fact one in which there are no central nodes any longer. It is, in fact, a decentralized system, a system for better or for worse. That is, you can use it in order to overthrow authoritarian governments, but you can also use it in order to organize terrorist attacks. It is technology which is neutral in its effects. So the two concepts, internationalization and globalization, which we have, share that they do not take seriously thinking about meaning. That is, how we think about the exchange of meanings and the creation of knowledge above the nation state. And that is what the concept of globalization can do for us. To think about the creation of community of meanings and the associated practices and policies which come with it. From this conceptualization, civilizations are contexts, they are not actors. For Huntington, and for President Hu, they're actors. But I don't think civilizations ever act. Civilizations are the context, the social context in which political actors make their choices. Now these civilizational exchanges can have different, can yield different results. The one which Huntington writes about is the clash. And I always wondered, right when I read the article, why is that the thing which he focuses on, other than that it's the alliteration, that is the first letter of clash is a C, and the first letter of civilization is a C. And it rhymes nicely, the clash of civilization. But if you looked at the scholarship on civilizations before, by Toynbee, for example, Toynbee has a set of outcomes of about 24 of what could happen when civilizations meet. Clash would be one of them, but there were 23 others. And so I think you have to think, you know, in broader terms. Violent clash is in part the result of a form of cultural imperialism in which the superior civilization, the actors within that civilization, impose both the content and the form. Korea was subject to such a form of cultural imperialism for the first half of the 20th century, so I don't have to talk about it. But there's also other forms of civilizational encounters, and the one which you might think about now, more relevant than the clash, would be trans-civilizational engagements. That's the thing, you know, which flows across the world, Gangnam style, okay? It was only a few weeks after that video got viral that there were 400 Cornell students and Ho Plaza doing a fabulous dance, okay? And you should click on it. It's Korean popular culture in upstate New York. That would be trans-civilizational engagement. Much of popular culture is of that kind. Here, we deal with a widespread acceptance of both the content and the form of cultural practices. But most of the time, it's not one or the other. It's something in the middle. I call that hybridization. The shifting, not of the balances of power, that would be the language of Huntington, who regards civilizations as actors. I would call it the shifting balances of practice. Now, that is not to say that Huntington is necessarily wrong. I think it is an open question, which has not been researched, whether the fault lines between civilizations are particularly dangerous, or particularly violent, or particularly problematic. As I say, Huntington assumes it, but doesn't study it. But what other scholars have studied is, where do the clashes occur? And the findings are uniformly negative for Huntington's thesis. The clashes occur within civilizations, not between them. So, while I do not regard Huntington as being totally wrong, given the current evidence, he is predominantly wrong. Although I personally think that his core proposition, that the fault lines between civilizations need particular attention, makes a lot of sense to me. But it's not been studied empirically, certainly not by him, but not by his defenders either. So here's the roadmap for the course, for the talk. I will briefly talk about how to analyze civilizations. I will talk about cynicization as an example of civilizational processes. And then I will talk briefly about, or maybe not, Anglo-America before I conclude. So that is the cover of the first volume of the three which I've produced. The cover is a painting from Kandinsky's Circle Phase. Kandinsky was a Russian painter. He was an abstract painter, and between 1924 and 1926, he was interested in spheres, in circles. And basically, these spheres or circles overlay each other. And it's that image of overlay which I think captures the central message of this lecture. So how do we define civilizations? They're primarily urban phenomena. Civilizations are always funded by peasants who are exploited. And they're always run by urban elites who like to eat well, dress elegantly, and be cosmopolitan. So they are the result of coercive power. They're defined by language, although it's not clear whether the language has to be written or unwritten. It used to be said that, oh, languages are not written there for primitive people. But then it turns out that, you know, the Brahmins in India have an oral tradition. They recite the Vedics. So it's not clear whether this is true. And of course, language in the era of Google and automatic translator, we are having now a translation team in the back, but give this another 10 years, there will be no translators in this lecture hall. I promise you that. It's a waste of time and effort because we will get accuracy of translation of up to 98 to 99%. Then, of course, language suddenly will become much more universal. And whether that language will be Chinese or English, I don't know. But language itself will no longer be the defining characteristic of a particular civilization. It may become the defining characteristic, a shared language, of a common civilization. And finally, there is literature and religion. Now, religion, many people think that that's the core. But religion, of course, you know, religious divides in Europe, for example, were particularly deep between Catholics and Protestants. They killed each other in large numbers 300-400 years ago. They were deeply suspicious of each other in the late 19th century. Today, Protestants and Catholics get along just fine. But Christians and Muslims, now that's a big problem. So religion divides and unites over time. And religion itself, of course, is a subset in a secular Europe of a larger consideration of what I call civil religion. You could think actually of Confucianism as a civil religion rather than a religion. So these are the characteristics sharing an urban setting, language, literature, and religion. These are the defining characteristics of civilization. Civilization exists in something larger, what I would call a larger civilizational context. And here, the important scholarship of William McNeill needs to be mentioned. He wrote a book called The Rise of the West. And then, 30 years later, he wrote a critical review of his own book and said, I forgot one important thing, which I learned from a fellow academic at the University of Chicago, Marshall Hodgson, who was the primary scholar of Islam. And what he said, what I didn't know about was that the West exists in something larger, in a larger cultural context. And this, for me, is a very fundamental and profound point, because civilizations themselves are never enough. They always situate themselves in something bigger. Now, civilization, as I said, they're not an actor, but they're a complex set of interactions. And as a metaphor, I would say, they are not a voice in our head which tells us what to do, which is what Huntington or President Hu would say. Civilizations crystallize values. No, civilizations are like a town hall meeting in New England in which we argue about our options. So the old-fashioned view of civilization, Huntington's view, dates back to the 19th century. It was profoundly illiberal, and it was profoundly racist. And it exists today, not only in the West, in America, in Cambridge, at Harvard, it also exists in the East. In one version, it is called Orientalism, and in the other one, it is called Occidentalism. What unites this wrong-headed view is it looks at East and West as being divided. And you find support for this in both the West and the East. Now, here is a very important conceptual distinction about how to analyze civilizations. There are two styles. One looks the way an economist or political scientist looks at actors. And it says actors have essential values and they don't change. That's Huntington's view. The other one looks at discourse, speech. It looks at processes, it looks at contested meanings, and it insists that civilizations evolve and can be changed. Now, these two styles of analysis lead to an important insight, and it's one where I think Huntington is profoundly right and his critics are profoundly wrong. If you believe that there are essential aspects which don't change, you're wrong. But if you're saying that there are essential aspects of life which can be, which you can argue look like they're not changing, then you're right. Hunting in his book was brutally frank and honest in reminding his reader from the first page to the last that his was a political book. He wanted to change the way his readers looked at the world. And he wanted to create a worldview in which you would think and agree with him that the world was divided between East and West. It turned out that the worldview he was trying you to believe in was a very old one, not a new one. It was 100, almost 200 years old. But under certain conditions, when there's great uncertainty, when there's a lot of fear, when there's insecurity, professors and politicians, intellectual and political entrepreneurs, can convince their audiences that the world is simple, that it's us against them. But those are political projects. They do not exist in the world as such. And this is not only true of civilizations. This is true of gender, it is true of race, it is true of ethnicity, and it's true of nationality. All of these pretend that the world is simple in dividing the world between us, between self and other. But that division, that way of thinking, is in fact the condition of a certain kind of politics. And so I believe that Huntington is right, that primordiality can be created politically, and that in fact he was one who created it. It was in fact the deliberate intent of his book to make it happen. So here are the three people from whom I learned. One was Shmuel Eisenstadt, a famous sociologist teaching at the Hebrew University. Eisenstadt studied a lot of civilizations and eventually came up with this concept of multiple modernities. He says, the world is made out of not one modernity, but multiple modernities. It looks different in Seoul than it does in Tokyo or Berlin or Paris or Washington or Rio or Nairobi. And for this, he said, the reason for this has to be looked in what he called axial age religions back in the 6th century. This was a theory he stole from a German philosopher. He didn't plagiarize, he footnoted. And he said, what is so striking about modernity is that every modern era has its own fanatics. So he studied the French Revolution and said, oh yes, the Jacobins, the fundamentalists, they were not reactionary, they were ultra-modern. Al-Qaeda, the fundamentalists in Islam, they're not fundamentalists and old-fashioned, they're fundamentalists and modern. They were students of engineering. Study in my hometown, Hamburg, before they blew up the World Trade Center. So, multiple modernities are created by the reactivation of these religious scripts, which are very old. And each civilization has its own form of modernity, and these modernities, I will argue, join in an overarching civilization of modernity. So this was Shmuel Eisenstadt. A second theorist, nobody knows, but in my opinion, the one who probably has the best track record in predicting what's happening is Randall Collins. He was the only one, there was one French guy, sociologist, who predicted the end of the Cold War. Randall Collins was the other one. Okay? Nobody in my discipline, myself included, had a clue what was going on, but Randall Collins did. He wrote a big book on the history of philosophical schools. And the philosophers hate the book because he is not a philosopher. But that wasn't his intent. He wanted to understand what was the relationship between Rome and Athens or between Paris and Washington. And it turned out that Athens was where the intellectual action was, even though Rome had conquered Greece. And Paris in the 20th century was where the intellectual action was, even though Washington had won the World War. So for him, the center of civilization was where the interesting arguments were, not where power was. It was the inciting of the imagination which created civilizations which were attractive. And it was competition within and between these civilizational nodes which made the world interesting. And so he was interested in long-distance networks. His map of civilizations wouldn't look like Hunting's, which was sort of colored parts of the world. It would look like exchange relationships. Who would travel to Athens to be at the academy from Rome? Well, any intellectual would. Which European intellectuals were traveling to southern Spain in the 15th century? Well, anybody who had any brains wanted to be in southern Spain, which was as close to Islam as you could get, which is where learning was, because the rest of Europe was under the iron grip of the Catholic Church, and no independent thought was permitted. And the third theorist is Norbert Elias, also not well known, a German sociologist, who wrote about the civilizing of the aristocracy, the coming of good manners. You know, in the 13th century, if you gave a dinner party at a court somewhere in England or in France, people didn't behave very well. They would stab each other at the dinner table. They'd steal each other's food. 300 years later, very refined, okay? They'd all sit there, they listen to music, they powder their hair. How did that happen? And Elias focused on the social and psychological restraints of society to repress the impulse which we all have to steal each other's food. But as a German, he was also acutely aware of the fact that these processes of restraint are reversible. Germany, after all, was a highly civilized country in the 1920s and turned out to be a highly uncivilized, bestial one in the 1930s and 1940s. So the process of civilizing can be reversed in almost no time. Any society which thinks it has become civilized is kidding itself, because there's always the risk of turning out to be uncivilized. So this argument, which Elias develops only in the context of European aristocratic society, I think can be adapted to the civilizing and decivilizing processes in international life. Since civilizations don't act, we have to focus on the actors, and they are political. And in the international arena, they can be empires, or states, or polities, which pool their sovereignty, like the European Union, or stateless polities, like the Islamic Ummah, or diasporic politics, like the overseas Chinese or the Indians. Different kinds of units provide the politics of civilizations. Civilizations do not act. But they can also be domestic actors, coalitions, groups, organizations, or individuals. They, in their fights, political and intellectual, create the pluralism inside civilizations. Civilizations exhibit multiple traditions, and they show multiple processes. It's not a simple story. So here I move to the second part of the lecture on cynicization. And this is another Kandinsky picture. I had an alternative there, which was a beautiful cadescence blue with a little red point. But it was so small that I thought if I picked this as the cover for a volume on cynicization, my Chinese friends would be very unhappy, because the little point was just too small. It ought to be a big, red, glowing sun. So here I want to talk briefly not about the terminology of the rise of China, which is how it's normally described. That is something which, you know, has happened. You see sort of a big thing having come up, like a sun rising from the sea. But rather, a set of processes which make the world suitable to China and Chinese practices through processes like assimilation, conformity, or acculturation. Now, the reaction in China to this concept of sinicization is enormous enthusiasm. I've lectured on this in various Chinese universities, and the room is alive. They think this is a cool concept. In the United States, it's just the opposite.
there the concept is very much critiqued by scholars because they're saying, oh, this is pretending that the world is simple and the world is very complex. But behind it is really this understanding that the Americans are afraid. Maybe the Chinese will take over. So I have no patience for either of these two reactions, although I admit I'd rather lecture in front of Chinese than Americans on this topic. But I want to understand how the process works. And it turns out that actually making the world suitable to China and Chinese practices is not unusual. I read a book when I was in graduate school a long time ago by Arnold Wolfers, and it had a chapter on milieu goals. All societies would like to live in an international world which is comfortable, where sort of their way of doing things and their way of life and their way of thinking are replicated. So this is not a Chinese particularity. This is actually something which is true of Europe, of Korea, of Japan, of Africa, of Brazil. And furthermore, sinicization is not interested in creating dull uniformity. Chinese talk a great deal about harmony. And I've asked them many times, what do you mean by this? And they say, we mean harmony in a diverse and interesting world. And I said, what's the concept which in the West would be used? And in the West, in American English, in Europe, one wouldn't use harmony. Harmony is apolitical, it's not interesting. One would use hegemony, a Gramsci concept, a Marxist concept, which says there is an overall ideological consensus within which diversity exists. So the Chinese view of what happens at the end of sinicization is not so different from how, let's say, the United States would look at the American imperium and what happens in its space. Now, this concept of sinicization is replicated by Americanization, Europeanization, Islamicization, Indianization, Japanization. Each of these major civilizations, in fact, thinks about finding a milieu and creating a milieu in which they can exist comfortably. Now, typically, from each of these perspectives, one thinks of civilizing processes as radiating outwards, the self changing the other. But this, of course, is a pious hope, because the other always changes the self. If you're interested in Americanization and you look at the global automobile industry, in the 1950s, Detroit was where it was happening. If you go to Detroit now, I just flew out of Detroit to come to Seoul. Okay? It's a very different place. Flint, Michigan is a disaster area because there are no automobiles being produced any longer. Why did that happen? Well, it turned out that the world kicked back. It remade Detroit, because the world ended up making better cars at cheaper prices. So that the culture of the car, very important for Americanization, remade America. This is a new measure which the economist invented to show what are the revenues derived from China of the top 135 countries for which they can data. And you can see that the rise of China means that companies which make a lot of money in China do a whole lot better in the last 3 or 4 years than countries which don't. This would be one empirical measure of showing that sinicization is having an effect on the economy. Now, sinicization is reflected in the military sphere. For example, China now has its first aircraft carrier. As an American, I must say I was delighted to see China invest in aircraft carriers. Aircraft carrier, this one is an old-fashioned one, you know, but a new one costs about $5 billion. But it does much less than a new platform radar spy ship, which you can get for $200 million. So I wish the Chinese will invest for a long time in the military technology of the 19th century in order to document the rise of China. But the increase in the military budget in China, actually, which worries the Americans a great deal, doesn't worry me at all, because the increase is a reflection of the increase of the GDP. It's not a reflection of a society turning more militarist. Commercial expansion It is clear that China's role in the world for sheer size is increasing enormously, and in particular in East Asia. It has dramatically remade the economic neighborhood in which Korea does its business. And many of you, when you move out of college, will be affected by the economic rise of China. And it has changed diplomacy. China, for example, is inventing a new form of multilateralism in Africa. Multilateralism with a Chinese face. It means basically making bilateral deals around the table, and when the time is right, you call everybody up and say, let's come and sign a treaty together. That's very different from multilateralism in the American style. So there are different forms of practices which come with sinicization. Sinicization can lead to ruptures, particularly if China were to re-sinicize itself, take itself more seriously, take its traditional practices more seriously. It can lead to de-sinicization, de-emphasizing Chinese elements. Or it can mean the recombining of what was old and what was new, a mixed outcome. And this is my understanding of sinicization. In the book, there are six case studies in which the authors track security affairs, economic affairs, and cultural affairs, and overwhelmingly come to the conclusion that what we find is recombination. So on the question of security, China believes in sovereignty, but it also believes in the concept of suzerainty. As a former German, I'm fascinated by how China views unification. Germany was unified when East and West Germany united. Korea will be unified when North and South unite. But this is not how the Chinese think about unification. For them, unification is not an end state, it's a process, it's a set of practices. And in fact, it's very important whether they talk about it in English or in Chinese. And they're very strategic in their choice of language. So, living in the world of sovereign states, the Chinese have in fact used cultural capital, which they have accumulated over the previous 5,000 years, to deal with the issue of national unification. And in that cultural capital, borders, the way you divide, let's say, France from Germany, are much less important than zones. And discursive practices are much more important than signing definitive treaties. On the economic front, sinicization means compressed development. This is, I think, something new in world history. The core currents in one society of pre- and post-industrialism, Korea and Japan, for example, industrialized very rapidly. Korea much faster than Japan, following the Japanese experience of the 1930s. But industrializing while you also deindustrialize, this is something new and different. The rate of change in China is enormous. And the second distinctive element of compressed development, you do not rely on a national model. Japan and Korea used a national model. In China, high-tech industry is foreign-owned. China has given away its economic sovereignty in order to develop rapidly. And this is now a big debate in China, whether this was a smart thing to do. Finally, in culture and diaspora politics, you see there a distribution of overseas Chinese, mostly in Southeast Asia, but all over the world, a lot in the United States. Sinicization in Southeast Asia will not mean the elimination of the particularities of Southeast Asian nations. Southeast Asia will remain polyglot and pluralist. It will not become homogeneous or Chinese. So I focused here on sinicization, but the same kind of argument can be made, and I've made it very briefly in terms of illustrations in this book on sinicization for Japan and Indianization, just as Japan and India. Again, one would focus on multiple practices. One would focus on the radiation outward of practices. One would focus on incorporation of how one gets remade by the world. And then one would focus on whether the power is rising or not. These processes matter politically when there's a rising power. They're much less scary when the power is not rising. Japan was a great scare in the United States 30 years ago. Nobody is worried about Japan in the United States any longer, although it's the third largest economy in the world. Why? There's a sense that Japan's power is not rising. So how to think about this process of sinicization or Japanization? It reminds me of the history of the fortune cookie. The fortune cookie was not Chinese. The fortune cookie was Japanese. It became Chinese. But I take it that you can't get fortune cookies in China, except in Western restaurants. That kind of trading of practices back and forth, like Gangnam-style dancing, is, I think, the secret of sinicization. So that's the third volume, which I will not talk about. I will conclude with talking about the bigger context, and it's in which China and other civilizations exist. And I call this a civilization of modernity. Two of the civilizations, I think, are different from the other ones. One is Anglo-America, and the other one is Islam. Anglo-America is linked to the broader context through its language, through the human rights revolution, through the institution, now institutionalized practices of science and technology, through its popular culture industries, and most importantly, through what I would call its ability to incite the imagination. Columbus wrote in his third letter to the Spanish king about America. And he used this metaphor. He said, America is like a ripe pear with its nipple turned up to heaven, a rich sexual metaphor about the promise of the new world. America is the only new world, capital N, capital W. Why? Because you can imagine life there in ways which has no bearings on reality. I moved to America a long time ago, and I thought about America as blonde girls playing volleyball on a California beach and eating ice cream. This turned out to be a very small part of America, but I found it very exciting, okay? So everybody can make up their own America. Obama, for example, is a symbol of America, and everybody in Europe says, oh boy, we wished we had an Obama in our society, somebody who represents multiculturalism. Islam is a different kind of bridge civilization. It does not link to the larger global context, but it is a horizontal bridge between East and West. It is the largest civilization in geographic scope. Now, this larger context is not deep. It doesn't have deep meaning. It is thin. And here are three scholars who have thought in different ways about this thin context in their study of ancient history, in their study of Japan's popular culture industry, and in their study of liberalism. Bragg, Iwabuchi, and Haas. Now, the civilization which I'm talking about is demanding. It rejects an imperialism of imposing a single standard of conduct, which is basically what liberal cosmopolitan theory does. And it does not accept the relativism of all political practices, which is embedded in the notion of Huntington's argument. Why? Because the civilization of modernity has two processes in it, and one of them I found actually in a book which you edited, President Choi, Human Dignity, and the other one in Human Well-being. All political authorities in this world have now to legitimate their power in terms of human dignity and human well-being. And these are constructs which are no longer come out of states or individual civilizations. They come out of the civilization of modernity in its multiple forms. And I end with a poem by Kipling, The Ballad of East and West, which is extremely well known, but only its first stanza. O East is East and West is West, and never the twain shall meet, till earth and sky stand presently at God's great judgment seat. That's the Huntington argument. The second stanza, which nobody remembers, is the following. But there is neither east nor west, water nor breed nor birth, when two strong men, apologies to the women in the room, he was an old-fashioned male chauvinist, stand face to face, though they come from the ends of the earth. So Kipling, actually, in his poem, represents both of the themes of this lecture. But I agree that the second stanza, not the first, actually has the endearing truth. Thank you very much.
I have a question for you concerning the terminology you're using for the word Islam to refer to the civilization. I think it's the wrong word to use because Islam is a religion first, not a civilization. And I think that the right word would be eventually Arab word because then it would it wouldn't cope the other people from other religions in this civilization, such, for example, as the Arab Jews, who are kind of living widespread in the Arab civilization. And I would like to ask you, why did you use this term? Thank you.
So it's a very important and interesting point you're raising. Should we say Muslim, Arab, Islam, or Islamicist? Right? So if you think, as I do, in agreeing with Hodgson, that Islam, the Islam world, is global, not confined to the Arab part. 85% of the Muslims live outside of the Arab, then you cannot use Arab. Muslim would be a good word, but Hodgson calls it Islam, and I take my language from the preeminent scholar of Islam. So that's why I did it. But I think it's for the purpose of this lecture and this project, it's factually inaccurate to reduce Islam to the Arab world. Because it stretches from Senegal to Indonesia, right? And of course the largest Islamic state is Indonesia, right? But you have an enormous number of Muslims in India. And I want to think of Islam and the global Ummah in those terms. I do not want it focusing only on North Africa and the Arab world. That's the reason.
In your lecture, you mentioned that the civilization is something we create. But I believe we cannot create or make civilization. Let me say again. You mentioned that civilization is something we create, some community we create of meaning and practice. Is that right? But I believe that the community is not something we can create. It is something grow up.
It's something what?
Growing up.
Grow.
We can create organization, but we cannot create community. So I believe, if you believe civilization is something community, how can we create?
Right. So community for me is a kind of structure. And I think all structures are the result of practices. They become structures through their daily reinstantiation and practice. So here's an example. Normally I take a shower, but I'm sitting in a nice hotel, I can't sleep at night, this time I took a bath, okay? When you pull the stopper out and you watch the water go out, there's a little indentation. That's a structure, but it's the water molecules passing through it which make the indentation. And the same way with any structure. All structures are made out of practices. All social structures, all political structures are the result of human practices. It's a theoretical form of thinking about the world. Can we guarantee the success? No. We can't guarantee the success. But we create it and recreate the structure like this lecture hall today by meeting here. This is the fifth Miwon lecture, right? So the first one was different because it didn't have a tradition yet.
But by now, you got a TV camera and a webcam, right? Probably didn't happen first. You innovate, you adapt, you make it work. So in that sense, I think the emphasis on practices tries to say the community of meanings are made and remade through human practices. And the implication of that is that our lives, our individual lives, little and insignificant as they are, in all our different ways, as teachers or as students or politicians or presidents or prophets or priests, I don't care, they make a difference. Because otherwise, our lives become insignificant. But in the context of this formulation, they make a difference. That's why I chose the life as a teacher. It makes a difference. It recreates a social structure, right? And hopefully by changing some students' minds.
Thank you, Professor Katzenstein. Since you brought up the concept of civilization, I would like to ask your opinion on whether you think the index of civilization actually exists or not. And if
the index?
Index, yes. The standard of what we say.
The standard of civilization, yes. Yes. Right.
And if it exists, something like a civilized society,
right.
How should we develop the society, or in what ways should the society should develop?
Right. I think that's it's a difficult question, and it's politically very explosive. So the standard of civilization, this was the language of the 19th century, was basing, yes, there is a standard. And you ask, what was the standard? They say, oh, it's a European standard. This didn't sit too well with most peoples of the world, right? But the Europeans had the power. They had the money, they had the guns, right? They had the missionaries, right? They said, it's our standard. Over the last 150 years, this has changed. So now, with these multiple civilizations, there is no one standard. That's the big problem. The liberals say there is one standard, our standard, the liberal standard. Liberals have said this for 150 years, mostly in English language. And they shout it, and people aren't listening, because it isn't true. It's the old-fashioned view of the world. Instead, I would argue, what you have in this civilization of modernity are processes like Sinicization or Europeanization or Americanization, and they focus on two things, human dignity and human well-being. And you cannot run any country any longer, whether that is Syria or North Korea, I don't care, and not take those two things seriously. Your legitimacy as a political leader or political system hangs on that. It doesn't hang on the barrels of the gun. And where do they come from? They come from from these two processes. They are no longer part of the territorial world. And they do not provide for an unambiguous standard. They provide a script. What you make out of the script, how you implement human dignity or human well-being, that varies quite substantially, which creates this world of multiple modernities, right? So the standard, or what you call the index, if you say, is there one, I say no. I think the development of world history in the last 150 years has been away from it, and for good measure. I think this is a progressive move. I read an important book by Chuck Bites, who is a political philosopher, and it's a book which addresses your question, and his answer is slightly different. He says, what we have found in the last 50 years is a common language in which we can now disagree. So you might say, well, the disagreement is what matters. But as a philosopher, he says, no. It's the finding of a common language. This has never happened before. I think it's a profound insight. Because communities are united not by agreeing. That's the consensus view, and we all agree. That's Huntington's view. I don't think so. Communities are united by agreeing where the important points on which they want to disagree. It's disagreement which unites us. Because we decide this, here are the points in which we have to fight. With words and ideas, not with guns. Okay. So I think it's a very important question, and Bites' argument that we have found a language with which to disagree, I think is quite profound. But most political scientists will say, but if we disagree, then it doesn't matter. And I think that's a very narrow view of the world. Right.
If I'm not mistaken, my understanding is that you seem to support the claim that we need a sort of a dynamic understanding of civilizations, because civilizations are not unchanging, are not just fixed forever. Right. So, but it reminds me of the fact that the civilizations are, I mean, coming and going. So, and it also reminds me of the fact that you were in charge of the U.S. standing in the world report or project a couple of years ago. So if we can assume that the U.S. standing in the world is in decline, how does that play out in our better understanding of dynamic aspect of civilizations?
Mm-hmm. So your basic point is right. It's a dynamic understanding. And Brodel, you know, who was wrote a book on civilizations, once said, I think of civilizations in terms of a railway yard with things coming in and going out. I think it's a very nice metaphor. And he also, together with Jim Scott, said, if the peasants wanted to escape the civilization of the urban elite, they went up 500 yards. If you escape into the mountains, traditionally, you escape the civilizing influences. Right? So what about the decline of America's standing in the world, right? I see it as part of a democratic backlash against the Bush administration, basically. If you look at public opinion polls, things changed dramatically as soon as Bush was out of office, right? But I think it goes beyond Bush. I think the notion that there is one nodal point in the world, people no longer are convinced of that. No, it's no longer just about America. It's about a lot of things. And so I expect, you know, the decline of America standing in the world to be a secular trend. And I don't expect anybody else to go to the top. You know, Charlie Kupchan just wrote a book and titled as Nobody's World. I think this is profoundly correct. And I think if it's nobody's world, I think this is a good thing. Many people think, no, this is a bad thing because you need somebody to run the world, to take care of problems of collective action. And this may be true in certain areas, you know, economics. Or, but in general, for world development, I think coming to agreements will be easier if not one system dominates the world. I think the era of domination is rapidly coming to an end.
Nice meeting you, Professor. I'm a sociologist, and I've had last two semesters in Princeton and New York City for my sabbatical. So I've had occasion to participate to some talks and on international politics as well. And well, I'm sorry, I didn't know at the time about Professor Katzenstein, but most of the talks seems to what. How much do we American scholars have to worry about the rise of the China? And what time we are going to wage a war against the rising state? So I just simply would like to ask, how is your position in international politics in the States? Is, according to my, well, some experience, most of the American scholars, especially specializing in international politics, is very much realist and focusing again upon behavioral theories, how to react to the rise of some power and how much we have to fear, afraid of it, and how do we have to contain it, control it. This is the most of their interest. And the middle position, like traditional liberal positions, like that of John Eikenberry, even seems to be some minor position in the spectrum of the interest of politics in American scholarship. What's your position?
Yeah, okay. I think it's a very important question. I think on the facts, I would disagree. We now have good survey results about how many realists, how many liberals. There are about 15% of American political scientists are realists. about 70% are liberals. Okay? That is, the Americans basically have imported 19th century German geopolitics into their public debate. And they're paying a price for it. I mean, you know, it took the Germans 100 years to get rid of realism. The Americans are sort of, you know, in the second half of their run with realism. So intellectually, I think it's not true, but politically, I think you're right. So the facts, the evidence is overwhelming that China, and the Chinese leadership is fully aware of it, is going to be a very important regional power. And it has enormous problems. The biggest problem is its population problem, the aging. Okay, it's the most rapidly aging society by now. It's more rapidly aging than Japan. Okay. What are you going to do with all these old people 30 to 40 years from now? So I remember starting to study Japan in 1979. It was my first visit. And everybody was full of the Japanese Pax Nipponicana, and we were going to take over in the 21st century. Not the world. The Americans are going to fight our wars, but we will be setting the parameters of change for everybody. We, the Japanese. Right? And there was enormous nervousness that Japan would sort of run America, and yes, we'd fight their wars, but if you look at the Chinese, if you look at the defense budget of the world together, okay, and the Chinese are not an enemy of the United States, the U.S. defense budget is 6 to 7 times as great as the Chinese one. If you now add the NATO countries, so it will be 10 to 12 times as large. It'll take a long time for the Chinese to develop a military. I mean, the research and development budget for the United States on military technology is almost as large as the Chinese defense budget. Right? So I think this is an overblown fear. But I say if there's a coming war with China, it will not be started by China. It will be started by the United States. This is the analysis of John Mersheimer. He says, why? Because the United States says, we will not tolerate the rise of a regional power in East Asia, larger than us. That, I think, is a political possibility. What speaks against it is that America's running out of money. And that's a good thing. So if we cut our defense budget, we may not be able to fight a war against China. So this is my personal expectation. I think we will not have the capacity to do it, right? And maybe we'll develop the smarts not to want to do it. But I think China is facing an enormous, huge sets of problems, big, exciting society and changes. But the big demographic transition is the overwhelming problem. On my second visit to Japan, I met a demographer. And I said, this is what my political science friends are telling me. He said, they're all kidding. All the Japanese babies already known. We're already born. We are a dying breed. It was a little too strong, you know, but he was right. So demography is a good measure of this. And when I go to Beijing, people are very aware of it. The political leadership is aware of it. So I think this is an American preoccupation informed by a 19th century political theory. And it doesn't count. It doesn't take the facts. So it's driven by insecurity, right?